So we're talking today about really a beautiful, beautiful topic. Let me just reread the title. This is a work of poetry that Linda worked quite a bit on, this title. It's called Manifesting Transformative Change. Manifesting Transformative Change, being in harmony with the true self, which is really another look at, like, how is it that we, how do we change? You know, how does that happen, that things move in our lives? And what I can tell you is that, you know, I had the pleasure of having Bill and Linda come out to Manhattan last year. Some of you, I think, were there for it. And, you know, it was just a wonderful 2 days. And the thing that I'm struck by with Linda is the kind of how much she cares. You know, things matter to her. She cares deeply about things. But yet there's this quiet space of there's this quiet space of acceptance that acknowledges and accepts that there's a process of change that's not in our control, but yet's reliable. And that beautiful combination of, you know, of a deep care, a deep concern and interest in the opportunity of life, but yet a deep trust and a deep recognition that it's not on my terms. And so really it made such sense to me to invite Linda to speak about that topic today. So without further ado, Linda Pettit, and again, a reminder for the babies, there is a place set up across the hall that's super clear sound. So I just ask you to make sure to make your way over to that room. You got it.
Yes, testing. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank Henry and his partner, Sephora, and Svi, and all the other people who planned this event for the opportunity to come and just chat with you this morning.
I just want to say sometimes intervening doesn't necessarily
It's okay. It's a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate it. And if at any point as I'm talking, because I know my voice can get a little soft, if those of you in the back start to have problems hearing me, raise your hand, and I'll know that's what you're telling me to do, is to just speak up. Last night I was thinking about transformative change and how to talk about that, and I thought, you know, it's really pretty simple that I'm going to sit up on the stage tomorrow and I'm going to look like the same person I was yesterday, but I'm not. And you won't know that because you won't necessarily see what has shifted inside of me, what has evolved from within me. Yesterday when I listened to my beautiful husband talk, I heard what he said about thinking about getting a trash bag out of the cupboard and putting it in his suitcase so that when he got to the hotel here, he would not make more work for the lovely person who was cleaning our room. That he thought ahead about that, and in his heart he felt love and compassion and wanted to somehow make her or his life a little more gentle. I heard that, and something shifted inside of me. And then later I was listening to Keith Blevins talk about the single paradigm. And I heard what he was saying when he talked about how it's a 100% paradigm. And I thought about the times when I forget that. I forgot that recently. And I thought for sure I had found the one person who was responsible for my feelings and my thinking. And I chuckle about that now because it took a few days, but I realized that it was not an exception. But just thinking about how we do those sort of little things, those little games and tricks on ourselves, thinking that there are things, events, situations outside of ourselves that that are responsible for our feelings, and something shifted inside of me. I heard that. And then later I listened as Dickon Bettinger spoke, and whenever I hear or read Dickon and Natasha Sverdlov, thinking about their book, Coming Home, the gentleness of the feeling, the beauty of the feeling, just shifts something inside of me. And I go deeper. I touch my true self deeper. And I'm not the same person after that. My behavior changes. But you might not see that. It might be the tiniest little change. It might be that next time I pack my clothes, I think about something that's going to make someone's life easier. Or it might be that 3 or 4 days from now, when Bill is really busy, I do something for him and I don't even tell him that I did it, just because I know it makes his life easier. So we are evolving all of the time. We are changing all of the time. And most of the time, those changes are so little and maybe seem so insignificant that we're not even aware of them. I was thinking about how nature reminds us of that. I have just loved the babies here this last day. Yesterday, I was just in awe, and I kept walking up to people saying, "How old is your baby?" Because my daughter, my birth daughter, is expecting her first child in early June. And Bill and I have 5 children together. They are our children, but they were born from different parents. Bill's family were, 2 of his children were adopted, and 2 of his children, their mother left to go to the next phase of her consciousness. My daughter was born of my body with my first husband until he left to go and be in another space of consciousness. And those children are very close to my heart. And as I watched my daughter getting ready for her pregnancy, or getting through her pregnancy and getting ready for the birth, I was marveling. She doesn't have to think in the morning, "Okay, little baby boy, it's time to add another half inch. You know, it's really important for you now to lay down a few more dendrites in your neocortex." She doesn't have to think about any of that. It just is. It just happens. And those of you out there who have just had children, you know that process, that miracle of growth, which is so intelligent, so perfect, is just evolving one step after another. And then I thought, you know, at home, because of the warm weather right now, the bulbs that I planted in my landscape, the daffodils and the tulips and the grasses, all those things are starting to wake up. That I bet if I could rush home right now after the 68, 70 degree weather we had yesterday and pry one out of the earth, I would see that it has cracked in preparation for the miracle of life. And that if the weather keeps up, within days a little green shoot will come and it will unfold. Sometimes when you see time-lapse photography where you watch something just unfold, you get a glimpse of just how intelligent and beautiful this universe is, how perfect it is, and how it knows what to do. And if tomorrow, which is typical where I live in Michigan, the weather will plummet down in the wrong direction in my experience, and it will snow again, that little bud will know to stop. It will know to just hold on for a minute and wait till the warmth is and start unfolding. And I thought that's something that if we knew to trust that, or when we know to trust that, we would understand that we don't have to worry about trying to make change happen. That change is happening from within us perfectly. So today I want to talk about that a little bit more, and then I want to talk about something else, because I think most of the questions that I've had over the last 12 hours have been about this second issue, and that is, how do you change someone else? Chuckle, 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 because we all know we've been asking those questions, right? And I have asked them. And I think I see a few answers. So we're going to talk about that. How do you change someone else? But first, let's talk just about change. So the title says that manifesting transformative change is about being in harmony with the true self. So I guess the first thing we should just talk about a little bit is, what is the true self? And the true self to me is a little bit hard to talk about because it's not a tangible thing, because it's before the formation of form. It's formless. The only way I know to think about the true self, because this is how I experience it, is that it's this place inside of me, this quiet space inside of me that knows, from which everything comes. All that I am, my body, my psyche, my spirit, all comes from that place. I think another word from that place, for that place, is soul. I got to tell myself. As a child, I was very religious, extremely religious, and I loved ritual. I was raised Catholic. And I wanted very much to be a good person. So when I listened to the nuns who taught me, so yes, honey, I am going to bring the nuns into my story. I listened very intently because I was pretty sure they knew something that I didn't know and that they would help me figure out how to curb all my childish impulses. And they would talk about soul. And for some reason, I would think about the soul, and I thought the only soul that I was aware of was this soul. The soul in the bottom of my shoe. And so for a long time, I literally thought that my soul was this golden bottom of a shoe that sat on my shoulder and had wings on it and guided me to know what to do to be a good person. Now, the beauty in that is the truth in it, that our soul is always guiding us to be the best that we can be, because it is love in action. And of course, the silliness of it is that it's not outside of me, it's inside. And as Keith Blevins beautifully pointed out yesterday, it's inside the principles. It's inside the logic of these principles, mind, thought, and consciousness, as they guide us through life. So when we are in harmony with that true self, that place of the formlessness, that space of the formlessness, when we are in harmony with it, we're able to allow it to just manifest in our lives, to just evolve in our lives in exactly the right way for us. So I want to give you a little example of that, a very practical example. This past year, I've lost 60 pounds. And I've tried to lose weight many times in my life. It's been a lifelong journey from the time I was in college. And a couple of times I was somewhat successful for a while. And then before I knew it, I was right back to where I started, plus. And I remember very clearly that last January, when Bill and I were in St. Croix, while he was speaking to you on the video, we were having a marvelous little vacation. And one morning, Bill was sleeping, and I was out on the screened-in porch, which just happened to be overlooking the ocean. We were right at the edge of the ocean. And so I was listening to all these beautiful waves crashing in. I was reading this book, The Second Chance by Sydney Banks. And what's important about that is not that I was at the ocean, because this can happen, and the same thing that happened to me that day can happen in this room and did happen to me yesterday. It can happen anywhere. It's not independent on the location. But it did happen that I was on vacation and I was taking time for some quiet. And I found myself thinking, you know, it's the first of the year. I don't make New Year's resolutions anymore. But I would like to think about what I'm grateful for in my life and maybe what dreams I have for what could manifest next. And so I thought about that. I thought about my gratitude for my children and my husband and the beautiful life I have and the opportunities I get to meet people like you and my extended family and Bill's extended family. I was very grateful. And then I started thinking about my body. And I thought, you know, I'm 62 years old. I was 62 then. I've enjoyed really good health. There's so much to be grateful for. And even though I know that I'm carrying a lot of extra pounds on my body right now, somehow my body has supported me beautifully in the process of living. And I'm really grateful for that. And I thought, and that is the one dream that I have, is that somehow in this next year or two, I can find a way to be gentler with this body, whatever that means. And then I picked up this book, and I read something that I want to read to you. So the teacher in this book is speaking to the student, and he says, "The trouble is, you see this world as the only reality that exists. You have trapped yourself on a level of consciousness." I want to read that sentence again. You have trapped yourself on a level of consciousness. You must learn to take the limitations off life and see that there are more realities than meet the eye. And I thought to myself, you know, a lot of times, I've probably read this book 60, 70 times. I read it every time I go on vacation or go to take a trip or go or come to speak because it just somehow just moves me. I thought to myself, you know, a lot of times I probably read this so quickly that I'm going by, I'm like driving by all kinds of wisdom. I'm really going to go slow. I want to stop here because there's something in that I'm meant to see. And so I thought, you know, that's an interesting statement. And what does Mr. Banks mean? That there are more realities than meet the eye. Really, what does that mean? And I was just quiet for a minute. And I had a thought. And the thought was, the body that you wish for already is. And I thought, well, that's interesting. It already is. And I started to cry because what bubbled up in me were these beautiful feelings of love and hope and faith and trust and knowing that that was true. And then the second thing that happened was another thought came, and it was a kind of a chuckle. But wisdom often comes to me in a chuckle. I think it's because I've been so serious about life that it's always trying to say, you know, just lighten up, Linda. And the chuckle was, and, because you live boundaried in time, space, and matter, you will have to wait for your new body to appear. Oh, that makes sense. And I was flooded again with these beautiful feelings of love. Love for myself. Love for my body. Love for life. And I knew that I had been given a gift. And from that place, 60 pounds slipped off me. Now, I did have to cooperate with the wisdom that came to me. And the wisdom that came to me might not be the wisdom that comes to somebody else, but the wisdom that came to me was do this, and then do that. And then 3 months later, oops, got to change it up a bit, do this, do that. And so the process of changing was about keeping my ear next to that space inside of me from which comes the formless. And paying attention to that. and acting on that. And the change has been pretty effortless. I don't know that ever before I would have called weight loss fun, but it's been fun, and I'm not done. I'll know when I'm done. I don't have a goal. That was kind of interesting. As a psychologist, I always used to tell people you have to set goals. You have to give yourself a lot of rewards. I'm not saying that's bad. I have set little mini goals, well, 5 pounds at a time. That's made sense to me. That's made sense to me. The wisdom and common sense about how to change and what to do when we want to change comes from within us. Nobody else can really tell us how to do that. The answers we're looking for, they are inside of us, and we're promised them. We're being guided all the time. I think that's one of the most beautiful things about coming to sit with audiences in this community is that you know that. You know that. You trust that. So why don't you have the answers sometimes about how to get to where you want to go? Why don't I have those answers sometimes, even though I trust that? I trust that I'm being guided. Well, because we innocently, and it is so innocent, we trap ourselves on a level of consciousness with our own thinking. I had so much thought about weight loss. I had thoughts like, I've tried before and I've failed. A woman after menopause can't lose weight. Oh, it's so hard for women to lose weight. I'm at a set point and I'm not going to be able to bump off that set point. I had so much thought about it. And when I had that insight that the body that I wished for already was, I had the feeling of thought just breaking apart, opening up. And I think it's the most natural thing in the world that when we start to let go of thought and something new is being born, that the personal thought system kicks up its heels a little bit. I think a lot of what I was experiencing listening to people yesterday and hearing them asking me questions was the heels being kicked up a little bit. Because as the wisdom starts bubbling up, I think our personal thought system gets a little wacky scared. Because it knows it's breaking up. And we get a little frightened about that. And we start resisting it. And the way we resist it is via questioning it. Well, what about? Well, what if? Well, I don't know. This isn't, you know, we do that dance with it. It is the most natural thing in the world, and if we can be patient with it and trust the process and know that's all that's happening, then we don't get in the way of that evolution that is trying to take place from within us. The answers to the questions that all of you have been asking are within you. They're all trying to bubble up from within you. But if you can look at all the questions you want to ask, all those things that are coming up, and see them as a little bit of your ego just kicking up its heels, and maybe just for once say, you know what, it's okay. Hang in there. We're going to be okay. What I need to do right now is not speak, but listen. Alcoholics Anonymous has a beautiful saying. It says, when you're trying to recover, take the cotton out of your ears and stick it in your mouth. Take the cotton out of your ears and stick it in your mouth. And that's what I had to do, too, was listen. Not chatter to myself in my head, about all the reasons why I couldn't lose weight and all the things that were working against me, but cotton out of the ears, listen to what is within me. I want to share just a little funny piece from neuroscience about that. You know, Mr. Banks would talk about that. He'd say the first step to getting out of the way of evolution was to listen. And if you were listening, you would see and hear. And if you were really lucky, you would know. I would always wonder what exactly he meant by that. But just a little curiosity, I was reading some research a little while ago from the neurosciences, and there was a study where they were asking people to solve problems, a creative problem. And while they were solving the creative problem, they were actually watching on a spectroscan, fMRI actually, what was going on in their brains. So they could see the different areas of the brain that were lighting up as the problem solving was occurring. What was really intriguing to me and totally unexpected in the research is that the first center of the brain to light up before the person consciously recognized the solution to the problem was the visual center, the seeing center. The second part of the brain to light up is in the temporal lobes, the auditory center, the hearing center. Those parts of the brain lit up before the person consciously recognized a solution to the problem. And when the conscious recognition occurred, those two centers suddenly sent a lot of information to a vast network in the brain that solved the problem, helped to solve the problem, where the wisdom came to help solve the problem. I thought, you know, we should expect that. We should expect to see the dance of the principles in the brain as we continue to study the brain. And that, to me, was a beautiful example that when we are hoping for change, that what does happen is that if we have to listen, we have to look and listen inside of ourselves, we see something, we hear something, and then the intellect can support us in helping to act on that. And we can trust that process. We don't have to work so hard at it. If we can just calm down a little bit about our lives and what we hope for in our lives and walk around in that space of expectation, knowing that we are being guided, all the answers that all of us are seeking will come from within us. Even answers about things that are really as simple as losing weight or finding our keys or figuring out what to do when one of our children is struggling. Knowing when it's time to make the next move in our lives towards some new direction. Everything we need is inside of us. So that process, let's review that process. Listening to and from and for that space within, that space where the true self is, that space where the formless comes into form and we are guided. Seeing the guidance, recognizing the guidance, hearing the guidance, trusting the guidance, knowing that it's perfect for us, even when the world might say that's not the most perfect thing to do. I'll give you a little example. At one point in my weight loss journey, the weight loss just slowed down, just almost stopped. And I started listening within, and what I heard was, eat more. What? Eat more. Eat more while you're trying to lose weight? Okay. So I ate more. Guess what happened? The weight loss restarted. Eat more of the right thing. And the right thing that time was different from what it had been another time. I remember thinking that wisdom does change. It seems to change. We hear one thing and then we hear another. And I remember a dear friend of mine, Mary Webb Martin, who's another Three Principles practitioner, was on a stage just like this. And one day she said, you know, for me, wisdom is kind of like being on a sailboat. And the wind is blowing and it takes the boat perfectly. And you sail and you're just ecstatic about the feeling of movement and the joy of that. And then all of a sudden the wind dies down and you're just still. You're just stuck. You're kind of in the ocean parking lot. But you wait and you know that the wind will come again. And then it comes. And sometimes it takes you in a different direction. I think that's a beautiful metaphor for life. There is an answer to everything. All the questions you've been asking me, all the questions you've been asking Bill and others, God knows that those questions are on your heart. But the listening you're being asked to do is to that space within you. Our words can be a little light that shines you in the direction of that space. But they are not the answer. I remember once listening to something that George Pransky said on a tape that helped me in my personal life and in my professional life with understanding where the three principles were trying to point me. And he said, you know, when you're working as a three principles therapist, you are concerned about insight, but the insight you're concerned about is not insight that people have to their particular problems. The insight you're concerned about is the insight that people have to the nature of the three principles. And I realized that that was the answer that I was looking for at the time, that when I was looking inside myself, the insight I was looking for was insight to the nature of the three principles. And that if I listened for that insight, I could trust that I would find, as I more deeply saw the nature of these principles, the answers to all the individual concerns that I had in my life. And that has proven to be 100% true, 100% logical. I see heads nodding out there. We know this. So I want to talk a little bit about changing other people. Did you all hear that? The man says, finally. So I'm going to tell you how I changed Bill Pettit. I actually want to start by telling you one of my favorite all-time stories from being a therapist. This was just such a sweet experience. A young man came to me, I'll call him Bruce, because he was depressed. And he was referred to me by his employee assistance program at his organization. So it wasn't that he was seeking me out as a three principles therapist. It was because it was cheap. And he came to see me and he said, Dr. Pettit, I'm just so sad because I'm in a divorce process. I love my wife dearly. But we can't seem to find a way to stay together. And we have tried therapy. They had gone to a very, very popular marital therapist in the area and had done about 20 sessions with that therapist. And he said the therapist was trying to teach us how to communicate, and the therapist was trying to teach us how to fight fairly, because we weren't fair fighters. It was pretty nasty at times. And it just didn't seem like the situation got better. We were fighting more. and we were not communicating at all. And finally, it just came to the point that my wife said, I'm done with the therapy. I tried that. I proved to you that I tried that, and I'm moving on. It is what I need to do in my life. Move on. Done deal. Let's go see the lawyer. And this man's heart was broken, and it was broken because he really, in his deepest sense, felt like the marriage could work. And he really was willing to say, I don't know that I've done everything that I can do. I don't know that I really gave it my best. I think a lot of times I treated my wife as though she were the problem. So he had a little bit of insight already. And I explained to him, I said, well, before we begin, I need you to know that I'm not going to talk to you about your depression, or I'm not going to talk to you about the marriage or the divorce. What I want to talk to you about is how the human experience is created, how you are creating your experience, how I'm creating my experience. So it's really just a conversation about how life works. And the way I'd like to have that conversation with you is I have two books. One is The Relationship Handbook by George Pransky, and the other is The Missing Link. I'd like to read those with you. So you'll read a chapter, a couple chapters, I'll read a couple chapters, and then we'll just talk about it. And he was, I guess he liked me, and I'd done a good job of listening, and so he felt that I cared about him. You know, like Bill often says, and so true, people don't care what you know until they know that you care. People don't care what you know until they know that you care. And I think he knew that I cared about him, that I'd listened very deeply to him. Listened very deeply, not to his depression, not to all the things he'd done wrong, not to all the things she'd done wrong. I listened to the beauty that was inside of him. If there was one thing that Mr. Banks taught me that made a profound difference in my professional life and my personal life, was always to listen for truth and beauty. Ignore the rest. And so I've been able to share with this man the beautiful things that he was, how beautiful it was that I saw that he cared so deeply for his wife. And I also reassured him that I knew he cared deeply enough for her that if her wisdom dictated that it was time for her to move on, he would be okay with that. His love was deep enough to honor that. And so we had this beautiful conversation about life. And he started to see things, and he started to be filled with love for his wife, even a deeper love. And he started to see all the ways in which he had gotten in the way of that love. And he said to me, okay, so now the trick is, Dr. Pettit, I see some things, but how do I get her to see those things? And I said, you know what, you have no control over that. All you can do is love her. And the minute you become invested in the outcome, you're in your thinking. You're in your personal thought system that says, I know the right way that things are supposed to turn out. But if you can stay with that love, what more beautiful gift could you give her, even if she leaves you and moves on? What more beautiful gift could you give her than you had weeks, weeks and weeks of just being able to share your love with her? And he felt the wisdom in that. And it came to me the week after we had this very profound conversation about that. He said, you'll never guess what happened. My wife broke her foot. I forgot to tell you that at that point they were living apart because they were preparing for the divorce. And so she called him up and she said, Bruce, I hate to ask you this because I know we're getting divorced, but I don't have anyone else to care for me. I'm away from my family and none of my friends are able to do this. Would you consider coming in just for the next 4 weeks helping me get along. And she had conditions about that. We can't have sex. We can't talk about this or that. We're not going to fight. But I will accept your help. And so he said, I would be so glad to. I would be so glad to do that for you. Now, I'm sure, as I recall, that Bruce's ego kicked up a little bit. What the heck? I'm not good enough to stay married to, but I'm good enough to come act as nurse? But he knew enough by that point to just, you know, just not pay attention to that. It was just the ego doing, the personal thought system doing what it does. And to just stay with beauty and truth and go care for her. By the way, he had asked her to come to therapy with us. And he tried to tell her, this is a really different experience of therapy. We're not talking about our problems. We're talking about how life works. And she said, absolutely not. I am done with therapy. I see a lot of shaking hands. So for about 4 weeks, he went and stayed with her, and he loved her. And he came in a couple of times and he said, boy, this is a little tougher than I thought it was going to be, because it feels like at times like she's almost trying to trap me into the old behaviors, that she's trying to argue with me when I don't want to argue. And he said, but you know what I do? I just listen inwardly. And when I listen inwardly and allow myself to take a breath and I'm just listening inwardly, I get flooded with something. And I think what he would say if he were here to you today, speaking to you, was that he would be flooded by the power of love. Love is a power. Sid Banks talks about that. He says that when we're quiet, the thing that powers the evolution of change in us, the thing that powers that is love. Or what Keith called God mind yesterday, divine mind, divine thought. It is a power. It is a power that grounds us with certainty, always. And he would feel that power of certainty. No, stay with the love. Yeah, it's hard. Yeah, you want to kick up your heels at her, but stay with the love. And he did. He just stayed with the love and kept caring about her and caring for her and listening to her. Listening to her deeply. And what started to pour out was a lot of anger about the way things had been between them. And he just listened and heard her very deeply. And guess what?
Happily ever after.
Well, here's the deal. She started to change. She started to become more loving. She started to become more open. She started to say to him, I know that I've hurt you. I'm willing to hear out how I've hurt you. And he came to me and he said, Dr. Pettit, how do I teach her about these principles? I said, whatever you do, don't try to do that. Just stay with the process. But I do have a suggestion, and this just came to me. I said, do you guys read in the bathroom? He said, yeah, we do. I said, I would encourage you to just slip the relationship handbook in the bin. But guess what? Don't ever ask her if she read it. Just leave it there. If her wisdom guides her to read it, she will. I, to this day, do not know, nor does he, as far as I know, that she ever read that book. But I had maybe one or two more sessions with him, and he was telling me that things were going to get better and that they had decided to stay together for a period of time to see what could happen. And then I didn't hear from him again. So fast forwarding about 16 months, I'm closing my practice. Bill and I are going to move on to Michigan. I send out a letter to all of my clients saying, by the way, I'm moving. Here's what's going to happen with your records. If I need to close up anything with you, let me know. And he pops up on my appointment list. And he walks in. And he sits down and he says, Dr. Pettit, this is probably going to be an unusual session, but it was worth the money to pay out of my pocket to come and tell you about this. He said, I suspect you sometimes don't get to hear the end of the story. And I said, you're right. And he said, well, this story had a beautiful ending. He said, we just have kept growing in our love. It's not perfect. But when it goes off track, when our thinking gets off track, we know what to do. We know to listen inwardly. We know to wait till we're calm. And we know to talk to each other from that place of calm. And one after another, we solve the things that are in front of us to solve. We see what to do with the things that are in front of us, little by little. And we are now the proud parents of a beautiful little boy. And I never dreamt that that would happen for me. I never dreamt that I could have the kind of marriage that I have with this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful woman. And I look back sometimes and I think, how was it that I ever saw her as anything less than beautiful? Now, he didn't change her, did he? He changed. He changed. He found love. Little by little, he started letting go of judgment. Little by little, he started letting go of expectation. He trusted that power within him to guide him to know what to do. And the story, in a way, reminds me of the story of Chip and Jan Chipman, who talk about their marriage and what was happening at the first when Jan started to see the logic of the principles, the beauty of the principles, and she started to change. And at first, Chip was pretty upset. And he talks about how he tried to make her go back to the old way of being because it felt more comfortable. And then there came a point where he said, I want what she has because it is so powerful. I had the same experience with Bill. Bill will tell you, with my permission, that when we first met, I was a pretty spirited lady. I'm still a spirited lady. I always joke that this red hair comes out of a bottle now, but it's real. It was real all my life. I had red hair, and you know, redheaded people are supposed to be pretty fiery. And if that is true, then I fit the stereotype. I was a pretty spirited, passionate person, and still am. And when I first started hearing about these principles, my ego kicked up big time. It was flying in the face of all my psychological training. It was flying in the face, what I saw was beginning to fly in the face of my personal understanding. And I had questions. And as I would ask the questions, I didn't like the answers. And I would get upset. I would get very angry. And Bill would kind of back up, and he would say, watch Sid Banks. And I would put Sid Banks's videos on the video machine after Bill went to work, because I didn't want him to know that I was watching the videos. I mean, this is truthful. I'd wait till he left the house, and I'd pop it in and say, okay, I'm going to try. And as soon as Mr. Banks would start speaking, what would I do? Fall asleep. Seriously, fall asleep. Now I look back on that and I laugh and I think, oh my goodness, my mind was so busy. My mind was so busy. My personal mind was pushing me so hard to be perfect and to do the right thing and to be a good person and to have all the answers and to be the best. I was exhausted. And I didn't even know it. And as soon as I would start listening to those tapes, my mind would quiet down and I would do what my body needed. I would fall asleep. And Bill, I think, began to see for himself a little more deeply that you can't teach when you don't have a student. Right?
It may not be good, but it's
slow. And he stopped trying so hard. And one thing I will say is that during that period, those 2 years, he never stopped loving me. I would get astonished at what I would throw at him. I remember one night I was just so beside myself that I just said very ugly things, and I got in my car and drove away. And I spent about 3 hours that night wandering around the freeways and streets of Morgantown, West Virginia, thinking, do I want to go back to that man? The pain I'm experiencing is almost intolerable. And part of what was intolerable was that I was having this reaction, and he wasn't. He was just loving me. So I remember that night when I drove back into the driveway, it was like 4 o'clock in the morning, I walked in the house, he was sleeping. What the hey? He's supposed to be worrying about the fact that I've just been driving for 3 hours in the middle of the night. But he had left a little note on the counter that just said, I love you. And over he let me know, I love you. I love you whether you never see anything about these three principles. My love for you does not have conditions. My love for you does not have expectations. And inside, he didn't know this, but I was astonished by the power of that, by the power of being on the receiving end of that, that unconditional love. I didn't know what to do with that. And then one day, I was at my desk. I was cleaning out some files. And I pulled out a file. And I went, what is this? And it was a photocopy of the first few pages of the book, The Tao of Pooh. And the first thing I did when I saw that was, oh, how did that get in my file? I hate that book. Never could figure it out. But I thought, well, before I throw it away, I'm going to look at it. And there was a preface to that book, and I can't recite it perfectly. But it's a conversation between two characters. And one character is saying, oh, that Pooh, he's such a sweet guy. So sweet, so loving, so gentle. Just seems to, like, flow with life. Doesn't fight it. And just touches people around him. And the other character, and the character said, you know, he's the exception to the rule. He's the exception to the rule. But the other character he was talking to said, I don't know. I think Pooh is the rule in action. I think Pooh is the rule in action. And I think in that moment, that was another moment where I was listening to my true self. I was listening at that space where wisdom evolves, from which wisdom evolves, from which the formless takes form in a thought. And what I heard was, that's Bill Pettit. He is, in relationship to you, the rule in action. This is the way life is meant to be. And I remember taking a deep breath, and at that moment, I became a student. I became a true student. And when I listened to Sid Banks, I didn't fall asleep anymore. I was just glued. I was transfixed. And I read the books that Sid had written. There weren't that many around besides the ones that Sid had written at that point. And little by little, an appreciation for the logic of the human experience began to unfold from within me. But even then, I didn't share it with anyone. I said to myself, I'm not going to share this with anyone until I am convinced that it's logical. And so when I would have an experience, I would think about, does this really fit what I've been learning? Oh my gosh, it's perfect. I could find no exceptions to it. Not one. So I wasn't looking to solve the problems in my life at this point. Do you hear that? I wasn't looking to solve the problems. The only thing I was focused on was, I want to see as much as I can see of these three principles. And it did help that occasionally Sid would call our house, and he would call to speak to Bill primarily. Every once in a while, though, Bill wasn't there, or while we were sort of, I was sort of alerting Bill that Sid was on the phone, Sid and I would talk. And he would just say things to me like, oh, it's so simple, Linda. It's so simple. Just be grateful for what you see. And whatever you need to see next will come unfolding for you. Just stay peaceful and stay grateful for what you do see. And then I reached a point where I said to him, you know, Sid, I think I'm seeing some things. My life is getting more peaceful. It's getting calmer. I understand this process of how to access wisdom. And as I understand it, I'm just seeing the wisdom that is coming from within me more and more and more. But I don't know that I know enough to talk to somebody else about it. And he started to laugh. He belly laughed. And he said, Linda, what people need is so little. What people need is so little. What you have to give is more than enough. And all I would say to you is when you go in to your therapy office, just speak from what you know. Speak from your heart about what you've seen, and all will be well. Because what people need is so little. Now, there was sort of an interesting backhand to that, in a way, like, yeah, I know you haven't seen a lot, but you know what? It's still going to be enough. And it was. And what I saw when I started to share this with people in my therapy office was that they catapulted past me. The first client I ever shared this with catapulted so far past me that I was breathless. And I was humble and in awe and said, wow, there's something here. And that even sharing, when I think back to the metaphor I used at that point, I kind of want to almost like hide my head because it was so simple. But it was what was true for me at that time. And she not only heard the wisdom of it, she went way past it and developed a metaphor that worked for her that then took me farther. Her metaphor powered me more deeply. So the way to change other people is to not care that they don't change or they do change. To just love them and look for the truth and beauty within them. I just got that. Wrap it up. Look for the truth and beauty within them. That is enough. And you never know when the love that you have, it's hard to have and share love when you're listening to thoughts of judgment and expectation. But if you can set those aside and go to that space within you, listen to that space within you from where love is born every single nanosecond. And in your own humble way, offer that to the people around you. And trust that that is within them. That same source is within them. The same process is within them. The same logic is within them. Then in that space of unconditional love, there is no limit. To the healing that can occur of everything. There is an answer to everything. It's in you. Thank you.